Hey y'all, it's Mo Abdallah, founder and CEO of Good Faith Energy. Today is part two of our video series where I go in depth on the Tesla app and all of the things you can expect to see after you invest in a Tesla system. The Tesla app has so many different features, and today we're gonna be walking you guys through them one by one in an in-depth manner. So once you have your Tesla Energy system, you really know how to scroll between the different features and find the data that you're looking for. So follow me today as I walk you guys through my data and how you'll be able to do the same when it's all said and done. So one of the neat things about the Tesla app is that you can see everything happening in your home in real time. You can also access historical data if you're an energy geek like myself and really want to dive in and see how your system's performed day over day, month over month, year over year. So as I take a look at my system live, let's just click this energy button. And what I can do here is toggle between the house, the car, the battery, the solar system, and the grid. As you guys can see here, all I have to do is select this drop down and I'm gonna go to lifetime. So you guys can see here, my system was installed in October of 2020. So I only have 3 months worth of data for 2020. In 2021, you guys can see if I click on the solar button, you'll be able to see here that I generated there at the top of the screen 13.8 megawatt hours or 13,800 kilowatt hours. I was only expecting my 9.3 or 9.4 kilowatt solar roof to produce 12,000 kilowatt hours or 12 megawatt hours. So it definitely outperformed my expectations. In 2022, we actually had a sunnier year. So I generated 14,400 kilowatt hours. In 2023, I generated 14,000 kilowatt hours, so still exceeding my expectations. And almost 7 months through the year, I have generated almost 10,000 kilowatt hours from my now expanded system. I also had my solar roof down for about 4 weeks while I was making upgrades to my house. So this year will not fully resemble what my new 17.5 kilowatt solar system will generate, but I'll definitely have a full year of data in 2025. As you can see here too, it not only is showing what has been generated, but also how much of it was used in real time by the house. So for example, in 2024, I used 3.7 megawatt hours directly by the house, 0.08 to the car, 2.3 went directly to recharge the batteries, and 3.4 went back to the grid in order to give me a credit. I can also click on the lifetime chart to see the power walls. So I've discharged 12.7 megawatt hours through my two batteries, and I've charged 14.8 megawatt hours through them. Through this chart, you can also see how in 2023, I'm showing a lot more charge and discharge, and that's because I installed a second battery in late 2022. 99% of my battery, my stored solar energy from the battery is used to power my house, and a small 1% is going to the grid. I also charged my battery 90% of the time from solar. About 10% of the time, it charged from the grid. And the reason why is because there were times where Stormwatch kicked in. Stormwatch automatically protects your home against severe weather events, which may cause outages. So if the National Weather Service broadcasts an alert saying that there's been a major storm detected in your area, my batteries will precondition themselves they'll start charging off the grid and they'll try and charge to 100% so that I'll have maximum capacity for backup protection. So I did have some events that kicked on, and as a result, I wanted my batteries to charge off the grid in preparation of that outage. If you go to your Powerwall settings, you can see this toggle where you can change your backup reserve to as little or as high as you want. I'm pretty aggressive. I like keeping my battery reserve at 10%. I like to cycle as much of my excess solar energy through my batteries as possible. Other people that are worried more about power outages might want to keep a higher reserve of 50 or 60%. Other people that are less aggressive than I am might want to keep a reserve of 20 to 30%. Because I am on this Tesla electric plan, it does show up under my operational modes. A lot of folks might be in self-powered mode where it's just gonna cycle as much solar energy through their batteries as possible and power their homes at night off the battery. Whereas for me, I really like being in Tesla electric mode where it depends on the cost of the wholesale power on the grid. And the second that it jumps above 30 cents a kilowatt hour, my batteries automatically discharge to the grid in order for me to capitalize on it. You can actually see that here when I click on the Tesla electric plan. It shows you a view of all the Tesla electric members, the grid, and what I'm providing and where it's going. So I'm currently generating an excess of 1.4 kilowatts, and that is being supplied to the grid. If I click on this energy price, I can see the wholesale rate and what I'm selling electricity for at different times of the day. So obviously at 5 o'clock in the morning, the sun's not out, so it doesn't really matter. But you guys can see here that around 9 o'clock in the morning, I started exporting power today. It's a pretty overcast day in North Texas today, so there hasn't been a lot of power exported to the grid. It's only about 1 o'clock or 1:50 p.m. And so maybe later on during the day, I will send some excess solar to the grid. But most of my excess solar so far has been given to my battery packs to recharge them. As you can see here, they've been being recharged throughout the day, and I'm currently at a 100% state of charge. But going back to the Tesla electric plan, you can see today it's been pretty flat, 2 to 3 cents. But as some of these screen recordings show from last September and last August, that same sell rate turned into 375 pennies as well as 522 pennies, which I'm not even sure how it got above $5 a kilowatt hour, because that's the cap that's been set. But hey, I'm not complaining. Other things that you can find within the Tesla app is, your impact score. So your impact score relates to how many times you had to tap into the grid for even a single watt of electricity. So let's just go to yesterday for a good example. Yesterday, my home was powered 51% of the time from solar, 36% of the day it was powered by the Powerwall. I did have to tap into the grid for 13% of the day, but as you can see here, based on my solar offset for the day, I still only consumed 55 kilowatt hours from the grid, and I sent 94.6 kilowatt hours from solar, which means I had 170% energy offset. I can also go multiple days back and see my performance on a day-to-day basis. I can change the day button here at the top and go to the month. I can change the months by scrolling left and right. So June was really the first month in which I expanded my solar system and had the best performing month, I would say. So the next thing I want to walk you guys through is the backup history. So this section shows all of the times I lost power in my house, how long each of those power outages lasted, and how my power walls performed during that stretch. So as you can see here, in the last 4 years, I've had 36 power outage events. Now, take this number somewhat with a grain of salt, because about 10 of those events were me simulating a power outage, either for a prospect or for a client. So in total though, I've had about 7.5 hours worth of power outages over the last couple years. So not too terrible, but definitely still significant enough to where it's made an impact and had an impact on me and my family. The longest power outage we've had has been 2 hours long. If I scroll down just to the bottom, we can take a look at the first events that occurred, which really was right around Winter Storm Uri. So you can see here, I started testing a lot in the beginning when I first got my system installed. The biggest events that happened were right around early 2021, whenever Winter Storm Uri hit. So you can see here, February 2021, I had a 30-minute outage. I had a 24-minute outage. I had a 33-minute outage, and then I had a 5-hour outage. And that 5-hour outage has been the longest outage that I've had in my house. luckily, I had my system installed for about 4 months when Winter Storm Uri hit. So my family and I woke up, the house was warm, the food was cold, the Wi-Fi was on. And I actually logged on to Facebook, and that's where I saw that my neighbors were all talking about the outages in the area. Luckily for us, we were not impacted by that whatsoever. We have a lot of construction going on around the neighborhood, so you'll see I'll lose power for 9, 10, 40 minutes, you know, 10 minutes, 7 minutes. So not too terribly long, and it's noticeable. And I think the biggest thing is the uncertainty that one feels whenever the power goes out. Really that uncertainty, that lack of security, and not really knowing when power will be restored. It's not a good feeling. I wouldn't want it on anybody. So yeah, these are all of the different power outages that have occurred. You can track them, you can see how long they were, and it's definitely more than the initial 36 events that I showed you guys at the beginning. Once I clicked that down arrow and I loaded them all, you can see here that I've had 96 events throughout the last 4 years. The longest one was 7 hours long. That was when I was having my span installed. You have to disconnect your power for the day. And in total, this adds up to 24 hours worth of power outages. As far as the setting goes, I've kind of showed you guys some of the settings within the Powerwall app, how you can toggle between the backup reserve, choose your operational mode. You can also choose whether you want to have grid charging on or off. Stormwatch, we've looked at vehicle charging. You can see here that I can choose to charge on solar. So currently I only have my vehicle selected to charge on solar. I can move the slider. So currently I charge to 50% from any source and continue to 90% while excess solar is available. If I wanted to only charge off the sun, I would just drag this down, excuse me, and drag this up. If I wanted to go all the way to 100%, typically they say to cap out your vehicle's charge at 80% state of charge. Other than, let's go back in here. All right. Another really cool app is, another really cool feature inside the app is if I click on the go off grid button, I can literally simulate a grid outage in my home. This shuts off the AC current coming in from the grid. As you guys can see right now, I'm drawing 4.3 kW from my house. My solar roof is not generating a ton of electricity. It's been a very overcast day. So even though it's almost dark gray outside, I'm still generating half a kilowatt of solar from my roof. My batteries are at 100% state of charge. So if I click this go off grid button, it's actually gonna simulate the Powerwall right now disconnecting the home from the grid. And it's going to show me here in a minute how I'm currently experiencing a off-grid experience. So it also gives me there at the top of my screen a simulation for how long my batteries will back up my home for. And so I currently have 6.2 backup hours remaining. Now that estimation is based off of my current power draw. So let's just go into my home's thermostat, and I'm going to go ahead and increase the temperature. So instead of being at 73, I'd want to shed the load. I don't want to necessarily cool my house as much as possible during a power outage. So you're gonna see here on the Powerwall app within maybe 15 or 20 seconds that my load is gonna drop from 4.7 kW down to probably about, okay, there we go, 2 kW. And as you can see as a result, the backup hours remaining went up, or it should simulate here in a minute how much extra time I have before my batteries will run out of juice. So as you guys can see, it's up to 7.4 hours remaining. Now, one of the awesome things about installing the Span Smart Panel is that I can get down to an even more granular level. So as you guys can see here, Span has told me, hey, you have a power outage. It's actually estimating based off of the designations that I've set as to what is a must-have, what's a nice-to-have, and what's a non-essential. So, for example, I'm running my mini split upstairs currently. The power draw on it is 794 watts. I can turn this off right now, and you guys will see that load shed from my house, and now it's not there anymore. And now I have 1 day, 2 hours, and 20 minutes of backup time. And my home is currently now only drawing 800 watts. If I jump back into the Tesla Powerwall app, you can see it jumped to 7.7 backup hours remaining. I typically like to rely on my Span app just because it gets a lot more granular and allows me to look at what's off currently, what's on, and then I can also change any designations. If I know that the sun's not gonna come back out the next morning, then I can go ahead and turn some of these loads in my nice to have. I can say, you know what, my central AC isn't a must have. It's not a nice to have right now. It's a non-essential because I need to be able to power other critical loads, and it will move it into a non-essential circuit. And you see here it updated the backup time to 1 day, 9 hours, well, 10 hours and 5 minutes. And there you have it, folks, the ins and outs of the incredible Tesla app ecosystem, all the different features, all of the different things that Tesla has envisioned live at the power of your fingertips. If you have any questions about how the Tesla app works, make sure to leave them in the comments and questions below. Subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Give us a big thumbs up if you enjoyed today's video. If you haven't watched part one of this video series, click the link below and really dive into 4 years of me living with the Tesla solar roof, the energy storage system, and the Span Smart Panel. Until then, we'll catch you guys in the next video. Peace out, adios, and salamu alaikum.